to the World Sports Show on WPPMLP Philadelphia. Soccer-based sports talk covering local, nation, and global soccer. Broadcasting from the Philly Cam Studio in Center City, Philadelphia on 106.5 FM.
Show Charlie Flo here, John Negricio, live on Philly Cam on WPPN LP Philadelphia. Got one of our co-head coaches of Junior Lone Star, Will, joining us tonight. I want to thank you for coming in, Will.
Thank you, sir. Good to be here.
So it's definitely springtime now. We're getting ready to kick the football outside, and I mean, the only really big hindrance right now is a lot of rain in the forecast, but the temperatures are cracking over 45 degrees about every day now, so 60 degrees feels like a warm front, what we had lately. So I know you were outside coaching all weekend as well, John.
That's right. There was no rest. There was no off season. We coached through everything.
Well, that's the interesting thing. People talk about, you know, our preseason at Junior Lone Star wrapped up yesterday. But really, I mean, it's an ongoing process as a coach. And there's no such thing as really, oh, this is the off season, this is the preseason. That is, even if it's a preseason game, every game matters because we're always evaluating. We've been playing a couple of college teams with Junior Lone Star, and all those players that were redshirted freshmen or incoming freshmen to get minutes, everybody's playing for a job, everybody's playing for a position, and coaches aren't as evaluated as much on the results, but we're still evaluated because we better find that good 11 to put on the field come Sunday.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
So trending, U.S. men drew this past Tuesday to Panama 1-1 in a World Cup qualifier down in Panama. The Philadelphia Union were dropped 2-1 in D.C., Bastian Schweinsteiger scored in his debut with the Chicago Fire in a header goal. Minnesota United bagged their first win, a 4-2 victory over Real Salt Lake. NWSL season will kick off April 15th. We will have Sky Blue FC's head coach Christy Holly on the show later tonight. So a lot of action-packed things going on.
It's good stuff. This is the season. We're starting it, you know.
Everybody's starting
through
up.
Through the rainy weather, but it was nice out there today.
Yeah, we have our first regular season game with Junior Lone Star tomorrow. Forecast does not look too good, and that's the thing, is there's a lot of fields in the Philadelphia area that are not turf. We're not luxury, you know. We're not privileged enough to have a bunch of turf fields that we can play on where we don't have to worry about the weather. So weather pending. Hopefully we get their season kicked off, but definitely looking forward to a big season. And I think the big thing we're going to talk about right now is the development of Junior Lone Star and how it has produced some world-class players, and one of the players that really comes to mind is Derek Jones, is now starting and playing lots of minutes, like 90-plus minutes for the Union about every week. And, you know, Coach Will, we've done a great job at Junior Lone Star just producing these types of players that it's a feeder system that these semi-pro and MPSL leagues are such a producer of these types of players. Like, what have you seen early on so far?
Well, I think with the state of soccer in the United States now, I think, you know, we do ourselves some disservice sometimes and not looking for the diamond in the rough. And a player like Derrick Jones can, you know, show a lot of guys in the country that you can start from a very low level. And if you're determined and you keep pushing, and once you get that opportunity to impress somebody, you go and go get it. And I think on our current team, we have a lot of Derrick Joneses. You know, we might have two or three Derrick Joneses that are just waiting for that right opportunity and to jump on it.
I think the big thing is why we have this U.S. Open Cup that we qualify for. 99 teams in the United States qualified for, and we were one of the teams that qualified. That it also becomes a scouting thing that each of these players knows not only is this a big stage to play on, you're trying to play for one of the oldest domestic cups in the world, But it's also a scouting match. I mean, there's players that have played in these big games that the next day their phone's ringing.
Exactly. I mean, even though this is the entry level, the first round proper, but it's still, you know, it's still a big deal for a kid who hasn't really played on any stage at all. So once you get to that level where the USSF is, you know, actually sanctioning the game, guys get excited, and rightfully so. So, you know, once we suit up, pretty soon we're going to know who we're going to play. I think the draw is coming up very soon.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to know
who
we're
going
to play.
This is our version of March Madness.
Exactly.
I mean, it's the idea that same exact comparison to the FA Cup, where all it takes is a few bounces here and there, and you're through. And before you know, you could play in USL Pro team, you could play an MLS team. We've seen it happen before where there's been some shockers out there. And, I mean, I think the big thing is there's a big misconception when people think that, okay, there's MLS soccer. What's the next lowest lower? I mean, lowest, like, amateur level. People think, oh, Division I NCAA. But, I mean, you have JUCOs that can beat D1 teams without a problem, you know, that we've gone against some really high-class college teams and did very well, that a lot of people don't think about. There are a lot of players that come from these backgrounds from Africa or the Caribbean that just didn't come from a good educational background. They don't have the grades and income to get into these big schools. And I think the big thing in Division I is it's a lot of the old man system where they come from these prestigious clubs. So like guys like Derek Jones, guys like Junior Sard, they kind of fall through the cracks, but this is their chance to show that, hey, maybe I didn't go to the best school, but I can still play ball.
Yep, exactly. I mean, when the good thing with U.S. soccer is not you don't see that divisive line from, you know, MLS to the next level. When it comes down to the next level, is just a scramble. You know, on any given day, a D2 team can beat a D1 team. On any given day, an NPSL squad can be a USL squad. So that's the good thing. We have the opportunity to get in there and, you know, just jump into the fire. And like you said earlier, a couple of bounces here and there, and you could be facing the Philadelphia Union in the third or fourth round.
Yeah, you never know. And I think the interesting part about a game like this is, as coaches, we don't really need to hype our players up for a game like the Open Cup.
No way.
But when you look at teams like in the MLS or USL Pro team, they got to be careful because the player's thinking, all right, anything but win. Even if they, say for some crazy reason, an amateur team goes in, an MPSL team goes into an MLS team and only loses one zip, that coach for the MLS team is going to be criticized. So they're in a tough situation where they got to win and big win and take care of business, where an amateur team goes in there and can battle with them and keep them 1-2 goals. They've done it. It's a victory to them. So for MLS players, it's the Open Cup becomes kind of a trap type of game for them.
Exactly. Especially if the amateur team manages to keep it close, you know, to the 75th minute, you know, those pro teams will start getting nervous. Like, okay, these boys are here to play. We better turn it up. And, you know, why pressing? They might break down and you get a long goal from here or there, a corner, a set play. And then, you know, we see, like, you know, the professional teams that start panicking, and then, you know, who knows, you know.
Yeah, it takes them off their game plan. That's the biggest thing, is take them off their game plan, take them out of their comfort level. And I think that we definitely got a good team with Junior Lone Star. We're just going to be waiting for that draw to see where we're going. If we're going to be at home, we're going to be on the road, a lot of to be determined. But it is a very historic moment in the club, you know, that you've been with the club, what, about 4 years, you said now?
Yep. This is actually officially, this is my third year. Started out with the U19s in the, you know, in the lower level. I don't want to say lower level, but lower level of the club, because, you know, these are kids that are just, you know, getting out of middle school, high school. You know, I started with the U19s, you know, and I progressed the next year to the U23s with the boys that I had from the U19. And this year, you know, had an opportunity to take some of the U23 boys with me to the senior team. So, yeah, it's been a nice little progression. And some of the boys that I started with from the U19 have progressed to the senior level. And it's good to see them actually competing with the older guys as well.
We do see that a lot. I mean, for example, at the Union, they've done a lot of times is bring an assistant coach up that has the experience of a player, especially with you bringing up 23s, you know, instead of bringing in an outside coach that doesn't have the experience. You already know what these guys can do in it. Game manager, I think, is the biggest thing. When people look on the outside, it's so easy to criticize a coach, but there's so many little things. Game, how you manage each individual. Yep. You've got 18 personalities dressed up. Yep. How to manage them, how to keep that number 14 through 18 still hungry, wanting to come next week. I mean, it's definitely a struggle and a talent. I mean, we did a lot of talk in the locker room about having the guys, everyone buy into the program. And I think that's one of the top things as a coach is keeping everybody motivated, even if you don't touch the field.
Yep. I think, and you said it right. I think about, I would say about 75% of your job as a coach, it's not done through tactics because you know, at this level, we know who can play and everybody on the roster can play. It's just, you know, finding a way to motivate that guy to get that extra 5% out of him when he's not really feeling at the top of his game that day. You know, just making sure you're man managing and make sure, like, how to stroke guys and how to get guys, you know, to wake up and, you know, how to get guys to get motivated. I think that's about 75% of our job right now.
Yeah, and I think it's also just, you know, how body language, reading players and see what the body language is and when to motivate them and when to be hard on them. And that's a balance as a coach is that yesterday we lost the game, a tight game 3-2, but our body language is a lot better than we were in other games where you gave up goals where, hey, we're down, but sometimes getting a goal scored on you can sometimes be a good thing because it motivates us to go right back at the team and get another goal.
Yep. I think after we conceded the first goal, you know, it was like a wake-up call. Guys, you know, their eyes were wide open. They're like, all right, we got to go get this one. And, you know, the fight back spirit was very, very, very good because we didn't drop our heads. We didn't start arguing amongst ourselves. We just, you know, picked up the ball and centered it and, you know, went and tied the game up, I think, twice because we went down the first time we tied it up. And then we went down a second time and tied it up. And then, unfortunately, we
Game of Inches.
Yep.
We missed two shots, lower corner by 2 or 3 feet. You know, so it's a game of inches. But I take a lot of positive out of that last preseason game. Is to me, like I was saying in the locker room, I don't worry too much about the final score. I worry about how we carry ourselves and how we were acting after the game. It was all business afterwards, you know.
Yep. And I think we're on the same page yesterday because for me, yesterday wasn't a results driven, you know, trip. We just wanted to see, you know, how guys paired with each other because it's now. In the preseason, you get a chance to try different things. And yesterday was the last chance to try different combinations. And at least now, you know, we know which combinations we think are going to work for the first team and in a real, you know, game situation come Sunday.
So looking into the season in PSL, what are some of the goals that you have here for the club and the first team?
Well, the goal this year, the bottom line that we got from the president of the club is to make the playoffs because we've been in this league for three seasons now, and we've finished third in all three seasons. So now we got to break through and get to the playoffs. That's the bottom line this year.
That's good. That's good. So a little bit about your background. You said you're half Ivorian, half Liberian, but you're born in Liberia, correct?
Yep. I was born in Liberia. Grew up in Ivory Coast, so I do speak French fluently. And we have a lot of French-speaking guys on the club as well. So that makes it a little bit easier for me to communicate with both the English guys and the guys that speak French. So makes it an interesting time.
Yeah, I just learned about one of our goalkeepers, Ibrahim, speaks four languages.
Yeah.
Because we have a couple of Latino players on the team, and he's out saying things in Spanish. And I'm like, Ibrahim, I've heard you yell stuff in French, English, now Spanish, and I never thought about that. That's something they don't have in keepers classes. John and I coach a lot of keepers, like multi-language keepers. I mean, it's such a big thing that one of our keepers, Ibra, is very vocal. Mm-hmm. And just the littlest thing is picking up certain phrases in certain languages, like bang. I mean, something I never really thought about in keeper classes.
No, so I heard there's another language he knows as well, Philly. So it's certain you can only tell a Philly goalkeeper that he'll understand.
Yep.
No, but it is so true. It's just learning key phrases and being a communicator in the backfield, and you as a coach that having to balance that out, the different languages and even technical terms of you have you're thinking on the fly as a coach. So what were some of your early experiences playing the game?
Well, I started playing the game very young, as and you know every African kid born in Africa does. You know, playing on the streets with no shoes, and it was just natural, man. We just anything that was round and could bounce, we use it as a ball, you know. And it was a good experience growing up playing soccer because it was like a refuge. You know, we had a little bit of a hard time growing up, but once you're on the soccer pitch, it's like, you know, you forget all your sorrows, you forget all your struggles, and you just play the game. It's just, you know, playing as a kid. You know, the game just brings a lot of joy. And, you know, coaching now still brings a lot of joy to me because, you know, if you can't play anymore, the next best thing is to be coaching, I guess.
Yeah, it's a thing that our bodies don't hold up as well. John and I still kick the ball around every once in a while, but I don't think our bodies could hold up for 5 practices in a game a week.
No way.
Physically couldn't do it. Again, if you're listening to us, this is Will with Junior Lone Star, one of the co-head coaches, John DeCriscio and Charlie Flo. We are a World Sports Show on WPPM LP Philadelphia. Talking about Junior Lone Star, who plays in the MPSL. It is kind of traditionally a Liberian team, but we do have some kind of transplants that are not Liberian. There's a lot of interesting like facts about yourself that you're half Ivorian, half Liberian, and just a lot of this club, you know, got really good exposure in the Unity Cup, and that was something that really kind of helped Philadelphia bring us together, all these different nations, and you getting there to coach. Did you coach Ivory Coast?
Ivory Coast,
yeah.
Yep.
So I heard some jokes about some guys who had to cross country lines. They had to change their country loyalty, change their little ID card for a game.
Yep. It started with me as a coach. My wife is from Liberia, so she was in a little precarious situation during the finals. She was sitting on the Ivorian side, and some of her friends were sitting across on the Liberian side. And they were making jokes, why are you over there? You know, she says, you know, my husband's coaching at Ivory Coast, so I can't root against him. So, you know, she made a good choice because we ended up winning the game 1-0.
Yeah, it was definitely a really good atmosphere. You know, we're looking forward to them doing it again this year. And just to go down in history, I mean, you're one of the first, I mean, the first ever coach to coach inside the Philly Stadium. It's never been done before, so that'll be go down in history.
Yep. That's definitely something that we can hang our hat on, you know, being the first ever soccer game played at the Philly Stadium, you know, and it being the Unity Cup. We got our name on the first ever Unity Cup, which is also something that we can hang our hat on as well. But, you know, this is something that, you know, the entire community, even the Liberian community, we appreciate what the Mayor Canning decided to do for the city. It was really, really good to have our boys on the, you know, those guys don't usually have, you know, a lot of time in the limelight. And just to have that one Saturday, that one day, to be able to, you know, the entire city of Philadelphia looking up to them. This was a good experience for our guys.
And I'm sure just the national pride of wearing your country on your chest. I mean, we saw the Parade of Nations, even the nations that it didn't make the final. Just I think that's the coolest thing in the world because a lot of us can't afford to go to these World Cups. It was to me, you're bringing these communities together, and there was definitely friendships and bonds made. The game got a little testy, and I think that's the part that people, I think some of my friends who were outside, think they were just going to watch some friendly game. These guys came to play. It got heated at the end.
Yeah, especially the finals was basically, you know, neighbors playing neighbors because some of those kids go to the same school. Some of them play on the same club. So some of the starting players on the Ivory Coast team was from Junior Lone Star, and some of the starting players from, you know, from Liberia were from Junior Lone Star. So the rivalry started at training because we both train in Southwest Philly. The Ivory Coast train on one pitch and Liberia train on the other pitch. So like the rivalry started at practices. So a guy started talking a little bit of, you know, trash here and there, but it was a good game. It was well fought, you know, and Liberia brought it at the end. They had a lot of chances. They hit the crossbar.
I remember that.
Our goalkeeper made a really, really good save at the end. So it was a competitive match.
Just the whole Southwest Philadelphia, West Philly is a very huge African population. And, you know, I was talking to the coaches and you guys about Upper Darby FC's kind of Sierra Leone team. What are some of the other, you know, teams out there? Because I'm just learning this as I'm just joining the coaching staff, that some of the teams we play. What are some of the other teams that we play that are different country makeups?
Yep, there's Salon FC from Sierra Leone. Okay. Upper Darby is just is another mostly Sierra Leonean-based team, but they have some Liberians on there as well. Kavala FC is another Liberian team. Junior Lone Star, we're like a United Nations team because we started off as Liberians, but now I think it's almost 50-50, but Liberians and non-Liberians, so I guess we're just a United Nations team.
Yeah, I like it. You know, I think that's the interesting part, what I love about soccer, that as a coach, you could really care less where a guy comes from. As long as he can play the position and play ball, doesn't matter.
Yep. And like recently we just got the two kids from Mexico. We got Alex and Israel, and you know, they're gelling with the team very well. So culturally we have a good nice mixing pot there.
Yeah, and I see that we almost have two friendly of a team, which I love. Is our team gets along. I mean, that's the thing as a coach, you always you got to, you know, crack the whip a few times to get the guys serious. But having a team that gets along and jokes and has fun, and we saw a lot of alumni come, a lot of former players come to our games, yep, and joke around. I think that's what I love about a club, that it's you're part of a family, that even if you're on a team, these guys drive in an hour to come see us play. I loved it.
Yep. And most of them that can't really play high-paced soccer anymore still come to practices just to be there to, you know, welcome newcomers and just to, you know, keep guys motivated. Because some of our best players, you know, that can't play now, you know, they're still showing their faces. You know, it shows to guys that, you know, you're going to be a part of the club forever once you play for Junior Lone Star.
Again, we're talking about Junior Lone Star FC, a Liberian-based club that has grown to be a United Nations type of team. We play all of our home games in Upper Darby at Bonner High School. It's a big, huge building. You can't miss it. You know, the trolley track's right next to it, so we do have a few balls that do end up on the trolley tracks. A couple players tracing balls on the tracks. But, no, we want to turn pages a little bit and talk a little bit about the last game for the USA. They went down to Panama, had a lead, almost going into halftime, gave up a goal to make it 1-1, but Bruce Arena's squad walked away with 4 points in two games. You know, they still are sitting in kind of that fourth place spot, fifth place spot, still looking on the outside for the World Cup, but still a lot of games to be played. They have played now, I believe, four games, six games to go. I mean, John, where do you see them finishing out? What do you see next?
Good question.
Yeah, I threw you in the fire there, dude.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you know, just going back a couple of weeks, we were saying that if, you know, what is expected from the last two games? 4 points? Are we satisfied with 4 points? I mean, I don't know.
If the tournament started with Bruce Arena, I'd be satisfied with 4 points, but we're already in the hole. We lost our first two and got 0 points. So I think that's I'm not satisfied, but I'm like, okay, it's 4 points.
Right. You know,
it's a win and a draw.
But historically, going down to Panama is tough.
Yeah.
You know, result-wise, you know, it's not an easy task. New coach, new chemistry to come in and just get a quick result, 3 points right away is tough. But I guess in a position that the national team's in, it's kind of needed. So, I mean, I'm not totally disappointed with 4 points coming off of two games, but, you know, we needed the six. You know, we been talking about this. I mean, it's gelling together. We're getting chemistry coming up, but I mean, need big results. We've got to get threes.
Yeah, the only thing I can look at is like your top team, like Mexico. If they can run the table, hey, we might not finish first, but if Mexico runs the table and beats everybody but us, you kind of root for that situation where let Mexico stay on top and stay perfect. Because right now they're just steamrolling through everybody.
Yeah, that's right.
So, looking on the other page, Philadelphia Union went down to D.C. this past Saturday. They were dropped 2-1. Definitely not the best of results, and it's really frustrating because now they've lost two games 2-0. They started off the season, you know, with two draws, you know, a really good draw in Vancouver, a home draw to a really good Toronto team, you know, that was runners-up in the MLS Cup this past year, but losing two games 2-1, it's not a good thing because, I mean, they are road games, so this puts that Portland game this Saturday even that much more important.
Right. They are road games. The weather's still cold. You know, not that it's an excuse, but, you know, it's still early. But, you know, let's take a look back. I mean, they haven't really won a game, and we're going back,
I think, 11 matches it's
11
been?
Matches. This time last year, they were in first place. A couple big wins coming up, you know, starting the new season. But, I mean, it just seems like the recipe's missing just one ingredient. And I can't really put my finger on it right now, but it's starting to gel a little bit. But, I mean, yeah, I'm just, you know, the mailbag. A lot of people emailed in, mailbag@worldsportshow.com, trying to, you know, give us solutions and asking us what the solutions are. But, you know, we can't really pinpoint it yet. I mean, there's going back a couple games, not to make excuses, but they did find woodwork quite a few times.
Yeah.
You know, some untimely penalties and just, you know, I don't want to say bad refereeing, but I'm going to say it because I'm not.
You're not going to get fined.
I was just going to say that. I'm not getting fined. The coaches. So,
we are coaches here, but it's on our team. That's the one thing about, right. We're not the press conference. We don't have to censor what we say.
Suspect officiating at points, but I think it was both ways. I think it's, you know, both sides unfairly.
I mean, RFK, let's look at that situation itself. That surface and that stadium is just a dump, dude. I was down there 2 weeks ago for She Believes, and
yeah,
it's bad. Like, when it started your season, you at least think your grass would be good to start the season, dude.
You would think. but it's pretty choppy. You know, it's very visible on the TV, especially, you know, around the sidelines.
At least buy some spray paint. Spray it green. Convince me it's green.
Spray it green.
I mean, that's what MLF team. Do you think that they would learn by now that appearance on television, you know, that, I mean, just waiting for DC, as much as they are our rivals, I really cannot wait for them to hit their new stadium.
No, exactly. I mean, it's a, you know, it's a big market. Well, I don't want to say big market team, but they've had a stable fan base for years. You know,
well, they're one of the original MLS teams, started in 96.
I mean, let's look. They've been successful through the MLS history. You know, they got a couple championships and, you know, spray paint it.
Get something,
get
dude.
Get cleaned up, you know. But it's just, you know, you got that.
Make soccer great again. I mean, they're in D.C.
You got that the cavernous feel. Yeah, it's like, you know, you're looking in. You can sometimes a camera angle for a good 30 seconds, you won't see a fan. You'll just
dude,
see
it's
a,
bad.
You'll see the wall. You'll see a nice Volkswagen parked in it behind a goal, big inflatable jersey.
Yeah,
no
that's the thing is when you have empty stadium, a lot of room for advertising within your stadium.
Yeah, they bring the car in. They don't bring a sign. They bring the car.
Yeah, exactly. We don't need a Volkswagen sign. We'll just put the whole 2017 lineup in the stadium. So, but, I mean, another factor is here. You got to look at the Union. They've only played one home game. This home game this Saturday against Portland Timbers will be their second game. So, I mean,
right.
It's very unfortunate, you know, that they've had this part of the calendar. But this is a time to piggyback off the three games in April. That you got to look at least, I'd say maybe target is about maybe 6-5 points. It'll be a good April.
Sure. That'd be a very good April. I mean, across the board, any team, you know, 6 points.
6 points in three games.
Usually you're playing, you know, you're maybe a division game, then you're traveling. Usually April's a travel till you get to the, you know, midsummer where you're coming back for more home and home rivalries. But, you know, it's tough. You know, you can go out to, you know, California and come back to Philly and have the terrible weather and then it could be sunny the next day, so who knows. But yeah, let's talk about the Union. Let's go dig in a little bit on some players. Derek Jones, we were talking a little bit before the show, and let's dig a little bit deeper. So
I think we've talked about something we all agree that he might be playing out of position, so I think it's a big learning curve. But this isn't playing out of position and a learning curve, it's not too bad. I mean, you will have said you've seen him play, you've worked with the club that brought him up, that he's able to score.
Yeah. He's the offensive part of his game, which the Philly fans haven't seen yet. I think if once the shackles come off and they let him go a little bit more, play a little bit more advanced, the fans are gonna see a show because the kid, his soccer IQ is great and his footwork also. So, but you know, I think it's a good position that he's in now to just learn the speed of the game, to adapt to the speed of the MLS. But once, you know, he adopts and puts on a little bit, maybe 5-10 pounds here and there, the kid's gonna be a beast.
Well, Philly's not a hard city to gain some weight in.
Oh yeah,
some me and John can send him down some recipes.
Yeah, we're talking weight like some mass, not in the belly. Like we got,
wait a minute, he's bigger, but he's slower. No, but that's the thing is getting that freedom, especially being a young player, rookie going in, and you're not given as much freedom because there's that risk reward.
Yep.
And I think once Jim Curtin and the coaching staff sees his abilities every day by day, seeing more that he can do, the leash gets a little bit longer.
Yep. And you know, I trust the coaches. They see him every day in training. You know, they know best. They're gonna know when he's ready to be unleashed. But you know, right now, you know, he's sitting there and he got guys around him. You know, when he gets the ball, he makes really good decisions. He's very confident. From the first game to the second game, you can see his confidence level has just grown. You know, he's just feeling a little more comfortable. He's trusting guys. Guys are trusting him, and he got a lot of good veterans around him, like, you know, Yerwu and you know, all the other veterans around him. They're gonna, you know, bring him up the right way, and you know, we're just sitting on our hands waiting for him to be unleashed.
I mean, let's say, you know, if the Union weren't in a situation that they were with, you know, being at the bottom of the East, would he really get that shot? Like, you know, my thought is that if the Union were in first place, they're looking to upgrade a little bit. But I think that being in the position they are, they're going to give him a little bit more freedom, a little bit more, you know.
Yeah, you got to tweak the system. You're losing right now, so you got to change it up a little bit.
Right, positionally playing, you know, holding midfielder, he's playing well, you know, winning 50-50 balls, you know, making the easy pass, you know, doing what is expected. But he might get a little bit more freedom now that they need that extra spark. And, you know, that's what I'm excited to see this weekend, where they're going to play him positionally on the field.
Yep.
Now, you told me some of the backstory about how he really kind of got signed on by the union, you know, play with Bethlehem Steel, just a kind of a little friendly game. You want to talk us a little backstory about that?
Yep. At the time it happened, I wasn't actually with the club. It was one of my, you know, one of my good friends that were coaching them. You know, it's just, you know, the kid, you know, came, you know, same thing that you see out there every day. You know, guys are coming out playing in the, on the dirt pitches, you know, having a dream, but, you know, also staying focused. So, you know, I think it was just a friendly against the academy team, Junior Lone Stars versus Philadelphia Union Academy team. And, you know, the kid went out there. It was not just Helmut. You know, a couple of other kids had a, you know, had a brilliant out, you know, had a brilliant, you know, outburst. And, you know, they caught the eye of the Philadelphia Union, and they called some of them to be part of the academy. And, you know, Derek stayed and, you know, just grew up in the Philadelphia Union Academy. And, you know, he was the first signing for the Bethlehem Steel. And then, you know, he stayed there for about a season. And then it was time for the, you know, for the big boy leagues. And I think he's holding his own right now.
Yeah, definitely. It's a great story about, you know, for a lot of those young players in our system, young players that are still battling to get back into it. Because we have, I think it's a neat part about our squad. We got ages from all ranges to late 20s to early 20s to teens. It's such a wide range of guys that have been in different positions of their life that I think that's the neat part about this team is you've got some of the older veteran players that are going to be pulling some of the young players to, hey, maybe my MLS, you know, sun is setting, but I can help you get there.
Exactly, exactly. And we have the talent. We have the talent. We just need the opportunity. Guys just need an opportunity to kind of showcase their talent. But, you know, guys are hungry and they're pushing. So hopefully this U.S. Open is going to be a platform where guys can just launch their careers.
Well, we're going to take a quick little break, and after the break, we're going to be having Sky Blue FC head coach Christy Holly call in. They're going to talk about their preseason and their upcoming season. April 15th is when the NWSL season starts up. You want to check out the full NWSL schedule, go to NWSLsoccer.com. It has the full listing of all the games. Sky Blue will begin their season on the road April 15th in Seattle. Like I said, momentarily, we're going to have Christy Holly, the head coach of Sky Blue FC, calling in on the show. But right now, we got some awesome tunes for you because it is Jazz Month here all over. So enjoy some tunes. We'll be right back.
And now, back to the WPPM studios in Philadelphia. This is the World Sports Show.
And welcome back to World Sports Show. Charlie Flo here on WPPM LP Philadelphia. On the line, we have the head coach from Sky Blue FC, Christy Holly. I want to thank you for calling in, Christy. How are you tonight?
Not too bad, Charlie. How are you doing?
Good, good, good. Preseason definitely around the way. The weather's getting warmer. You guys had a game against UNC this weekend. What's some of your early evaluations of the team?
Yeah, we're definitely very excited about this season. You know, last year was definitely a bit of a building block for us. It was an opportunity to try and establish the entity and really establish a new identity of the club. And this year, we really want to build upon that and keep moving forward. We've brought in some new faces, some very exciting young talent, and retained, I'd say, probably the 95% of last year's team. So, you know, there's great balance within the team now and quite a bit of depth. So we're definitely very excited.
You definitely added some new faces too. And this is always some of the tough times as a coach, because you brought a lot of players in and just getting that evaluation and trying to make that pick. You know, what are some of the things that you look for? You're looking for this year as like a certain position or just that good player?
No, we're definitely, compared to last year, we're definitely in a position where we can take a different approach now, where we want to find position-specific players rather than just the best players that we could get last year. And it's, you know, it's vitally important for us in the organization and the culture that we're trying to establish, that we find the right people as well that fit in, who carry the same type of values as the players that are already within the organization. So there's quite a few different filters that we go through, and thankfully, you know, the growth over the last year has allowed us to be quite selective about the players. And you know, there's a few big decisions to be made in the coming, you know, 10 days. But, you know, if we do our homework right and the players represent themselves very well, we'll have some tough decisions. But, you know, the hope is that we make the right ones.
Yeah, I mean, you guys did a great job last year bringing in some young players had young players with veteran experience, you know, with like Rodriguez and Casey, that those are players that played at college level, played such a high level. I mean, especially one winning a national title, that that's a lot of close to pro prep that you can get.
Yeah, I mean, Rocky's come in and she's obviously played in the World Cup and she played Olympic qualifiers just prior to the season starting. Then you had Casey, you had Leah Galtman, Erica Skrowski, all having very good college careers, and the four of them came in and had huge impacts on our team. And because of the situation we find ourselves in, we really asked a lot of them as young players. And, you know, to an extent, it was almost unfair. But as we enter a new season and they have, you know, most of them have between 15 and 20 games under their belt, it's definitely a huge advantage for us moving into the season.
Now, looking at end of last year into this year, I mean, how much similarities are we going to see in the style of play? Are we going to see a similar, or are you going for a different approach?
I think, we definitely, with the players that we've brought in, we look for players that give us something that we didn't previously have. I would imagine that our attack will be a little bit more progressive. We will definitely have the ability to have a few different game plans going into different opponents because of the variety and the type of player we have, but certainly very possession orientated. And I think we, you know, as we have some younger players establish themselves within the league, they'll be able to show their creative mindset and hopefully break down a couple of teams.
Remind everybody out there, you're listening to World Sports Show. I'm speaking with Christy Holly, head coach of Sky Blue FC, who compete in the NWSL. Guys got the season coming up April 15th at Seattle, and I'm looking at the schedule. You got four of your first five games are on the road. I mean, you're getting thrown into the fire the first few weeks of the season, Christy.
Yeah. Well, sure. There's no point then. If it was easy, it wouldn't be worth doing, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's definitely it's a very challenging start to the season. But, you know, we got the right players for it, I feel. The preseason's very short, and we have to stay on point with everything that we want out of the season. But the early part of the season is really about just getting results. I'm not too concerned about the actual the quality of our play early in the season. As we know, the preseason has been short, but as the season progresses, I definitely expect us to play a very entertaining and high-quality level of soccer.
Yeah, I mean, just looking at the preseason, you guys got some good tests. UNC's known to be a producer of national team players, a pro producer. Same thing with Penn State lately. I mean, that's becoming a regular thing with the club, is playing those two big programs, it seems like, every year now.
Yeah, it's really important to also have those relationships, and I've been, you know, fortunate enough to develop a good relationship with both Erica and Anson over the last number of years. And you know, preseason's not about results. It's about getting the best challenges in and facing teams that present us with different types of challenges, so we can find out more about ourselves. You know, I think, you know, we gain much more in insight by playing a team that, you know, might give us a 1-0 win or a, you know, 2-1 type game. That's much more beneficial to us as opposed to, you know, a 5-6-0 game against lesser competition. So we're very grateful that we have these relationships, and it's something that we want to use to our advantage as often as possible.
Yeah, I mean, you want preseason games to have, do a replication of what game situation is, and you guys had the game against St. John's where you got scored on. I mean, it's a bad thing for a coach, but it's also that good motivator that you're down a goal. Now you have that situation where you're down early.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it was a good opportunity for us to find out a little bit about the character within our team. You know, we certainly didn't expect to go down against St. John's, albeit it was a game where they had the one shot and the one goal, but that's going to happen in the season as well at different points where we may feel a little bit unfortunate to be behind, but we still have to react. We still have to understand how we play within the situations and still stay focused on what we feel is our philosophy and our way of playing. So, you know, it definitely, having those presents challenges, but we come away learning so much more about ourselves and ultimately prepares us that little bit better for the season.
Now, looking forward for 2017, last year you guys finished seventh place. Is there anything you've put in front of the coaching staff or the players that, hey, we're trying to finish this number or get into playoffs or such a thing? What are some of the goals for this year?
So, you know, the vision that we have for this club, it's definitely something that we're very, very ambitious about. You know, and ultimately our aim is to make sure that week in, week out, we put in the best performance possible for the group of players that we have. And, you know, we're very confident that if we play to our level of expectation week in, week out, it'll be a successful season. So, you know, as opposed to focusing solely on the single outcome at the end of the season, we know that the league's highly competitive. There's not one team in this league that is going to run away with it. So rather than focusing in on the last couple of games of September, it's really important that we focus week by week and ensure that we're putting in the best possible performance, and the outcome will look after itself, you know.
Just a reminder to the listeners out there, April 30th, it's a Sunday. You guys host Kansas City, so that'll be an interesting game to see, because Kansas City definitely had an off season with their first years in the league that they didn't make the playoffs. So, you know, they're going to be trying to right their ship this year and come out with a good form.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, Vlaco's going to be looking after that team. He's done a great job in the off season. And, you know, I expect that to continue. They, you know, they had some last minute absentees last season due to various reasons, whether it was retirement or, you know, pregnancies, but there's, you know, we can't be fooled by that. They're an exceptionally talented team with a lot of depth and a fantastic coach, so they'll be back. They'll be looking to push on from where they were 2 years ago, and they certainly have the personnel to do that. So we have to be on top of our game, and we have to give them respect that they deserve for what they have done and what they can do. But ultimately, we're going to focus on ourselves and ensure that, again, if we put in our best possible performance, the outcomes will definitely look after themselves.
And you definitely got a player that's getting near the end of her career, and Christine Rampone. I mean, what has it been like coaching Captain America these last couple of years?
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody at this point is, you know, anybody that's in soccer has been fortunate enough to see what she's done for the game. It's not only what she's achieved herself, but how she's helped transform the game and bring that level of respect to the female game. From my standpoint, I'm exceptionally fortunate to have that as the captain of our team, and you know, she's almost our North Star. You know, when we face a bit of adversity, people certainly look to her, and you know, she's a very quiet leader. And it's not so much always about telling people what to do. It's definitely showing them what to do, and that's by making good decisions when we're under pressure. And you know, it's for me, it's as a younger coach in the league, it's like my cheat code. I can definitely lean on that, and she's a fantastic crutch for us to have. But you know, our aim as well is to ensure that, to galvanize what has been an exceptional career. We want to make sure that she has a very successful season and a great send-off to a fantastic career.
Again, everyone, this is Christy Holly, head coach of Sky Blue FC. Christy, I want to thank you for calling in. Wish you the best of luck in the season. Hope to make a couple games again this year, and thank you for everything you do for the women's game.
Oh, my pleasure, Charlie. Likewise, it's great to have you around, and hopefully we'll see you up at a few games this year.
All right.
Wearing your Sky Blue jerseys.
Yeah, definitely. I'll see. I'm wearing a Sky Blue shirt right now.
That's what we like to hear. We don't want to hear any other NWSL teams.
Thanks a lot for calling in. Appreciate it.
Not a problem, Charlie. Take care.
That was Christy Holly, head coach of Sky Blue FC, and I was with the team a couple years ago as their play-by-play guy, so they did give me some good swag, so I'm very happy, you know, and it's the Nike whatever dry fit, so it doesn't wrinkle. I'm all about the guy clothes. I have dress shirts that don't wrinkle. Dude, that's like the guy go-to, anybody go-to. It's like the coaching sweat tracksuit. That's how I would prefer to dress. If tracksuits were acceptable suits in the business world, I'd be a happy man.
There you go. You just have your invention.
the tracksuit for men.
That's right.
Especially I live in South Philly, you know. I mean, go to any diner wearing a tracksuit, I fit right in. That's why I like coaching days. And John and I, we've joked, Will, about some coaches on the sidelines are wearing like the three-piece suit.
Mm-hmm.
And we were talking about England's head coach, Mark Sampson, and a few games they had about a month ago, a couple games in Philly, D.C. One game he's wearing a suit, one game he's wearing a tracksuit. So it's all about how you are a certain day. I feel as an assistant coach can't wear a suit. I don't know. I think it's a violation. What do you guys think? Assistant coach, goalkeeper coach can't wear a suit because you're out there getting your players warmed up.
You got a point there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think the suit should be reserved just for the head guy.
The head guy, yeah.
Yeah.
I can't come showing up looking better than my head coach.
Yeah, no.
Talk about like getting some attention. Like, dude, what are you doing?
Yeah.
How about shorts?
Shorts?
Can the assistant coach wear shorts?
Yes, I have, and I do. Three quarters, shorts, whatever you call it.
I think it's, yeah, the mark of the keeper trainer to have the three-quarter.
Yeah, because I'm out there busting a sweat with my players, getting them warmed up, the grit, you know, where you have different kinds of head coaches. Some head coaches will be in their nitty-gritty warming players up, or some are just letting the assistants warm up, and he's sitting there, he or she's sitting there evaluating.
Yep. I think that's the best way to do it. You know, you just let, you know, the assistants, you know, get their fingernails dirty, and then you just, you know, sit there and, you know, think about.
Yeah, you might have your 11 in your mind.
Exactly.
But you need to see who's going to be going in as your subs when you're limited on three subs, and depending on which league you're in. But you really got to see which guy or gal's sharp that day.
Yeah, because I'm sorry, so sometimes during warm-ups you can tell who's up that day, you know, because you know, especially yesterday, I could see some guys that were now on the starting teams just, you know, pushing it harder than the guys who were selected as starters, because you know they might be like, okay, I might not be in the starting lineup, but when the time comes for coach to look to the bench, I want to be the first guy, you know, he looks at.
So do you have any, like, checks? I know that, you know, myself, I sit back and I observe. That's my first. But do you have any, I guess, drills or tricks that you do with the guys to check their sharpness?
Yeah, it's because, you know, when we – I have a little routine that they do after regular warm-ups. We get into really, really tight quarters, three-touch ball. And you can tell if a guy's on that day because, you know, when he touches the ball, you know, the way he gives a pass, you can tell that, you know, oh, is this guy still sleeping, or is this guy, you know, is right, he ready to play today, you know?
Mm-hmm. No, it's so true. Now that our players out there listening know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
A little inside tip there, but now you're always being watched.
Yep.
You know, and I think that's the part I enjoy about coaching this level above. You know, I've coached some of the youth level where it's the kids are there to have fun, and I get it. And then some of the serious isn't as there from the players as much, but at this level, they know every single drill is important. They're being watched every single time. This isn't just a – you're on a rec team. I'm just trying to fill 45 minutes here.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, you know, we're at this point where it's psychology, you know, basically the psychology class. Like we should get certificates in psychology because we're trying to analyze our players, you know, post-game, pre-game, on the field, and just see sharpness is key in soccer.
Yep.
Well, something I noticed that goes with psychology, that depending on the game, sometimes I like to sit with my players. Sometimes I like to pull away and take my notes privately so the players don't see the notes. But I noticed something at Wilmington, and I'm not saying their system is better, good, or bad at Wilmington University. They have their bench, and then they have a separate 10 feet away from the bench for luxury, like first-class airline seats for the coaches. Mm-hmm. And to me, I as a coach, usually like to sit with my players and talk to, especially talk to players that got pulled off, to tell them why they got pulled off and what they can do. And I just want to get you guys' opinion about coaches sitting all by themselves away from the players. I don't know. Is that a good or bad thing? What do you think?
I mean, I can start. I think it's one, if it was my team that had it, it's the best idea in the world.
Okay.
If it's their team, you know, if it's their team that has it, I might think a little bit different.
Okay, because you're trying to use it to your advantage.
If it's my team,
yeah.
I got a luxury seat over there. Mm-hmm. It's the best idea in the world. Are you kidding me? Heated seats, air conditioned seats, popcorn. Yeah. You know,
yeah. What are you there to do, John?
All honest, I'm a talk to player type of coach. You know, I need my space to look and do my note taking and do my, you know, what I have to do as a coach, did my prep work. But it's the communication factor is huge, and to be away from players, you know, somebody on the staff who doesn't interact with the players, like, you know, would sit, in my opinion. But I'm more of a sit in the middle of the bench or sit off, you know, and make them decisions. Coaching always goes on all game. I'm always coaching.
Yep. And I think I'm on the same page with you guys because, you know, when you're there and, you know, you're all seeing a game from a similar angle, you're all sitting together, you know, you can coach.
Yeah.
You know, you can't coach if you're not sitting with them.
Especially the next guy up. You're able to pull him next to you, talk to you, and then point him out right there.
Exactly. You're sitting with them. You know, when you see something, you can just look over your shoulder and say, hey, guys, did you see that? When you get in, try to do something a little different from that. But if you're sitting, you know, 5-10 feet away from them.
It does seem kind of secretive.
Yeah. You know, like, what are the coaches doing over there? You know,
I mean, a lot of my notes, I learned, I've got such bad handwriting. You guys can see my clipboard. Nobody can read my handwriting anyway. So, like, you can sit next to me and I can be taking notes on you. But I learned I have a lot of little codes and acronyms that I take for myself that only I know, because that's the last thing I would do is see a player walk by and see that I'm – because you're going to write negative things, because there's things that I need to work on for the next practice. I had about 10 things that I wrote down yesterday that I'll work on our next training session.
Yep. Right, and it's that one chance that you can get to maybe influence a younger player. You know, for an example, you know, growing up, I have coaches, you know, when I was 7 or 8 years old, I just remember one thing that they've told me, and it was normally sitting on the bench, you know, during a game. And if you miss those opportunities to make a coaching point, that might be it. You might lose that point, and it might influence the player, like, hey, they forget this reason why, and then they get older, and then they might not do it as an older player or a senior player. So always take them times, even at the senior level, to hammer home those points, or just, you know, be transparent and communicate with them. So I think that bench idea, you know, if it was on my team, it'd be nice and comfortable, especially if it had the recliner leg like that.
You would try to get your tenure at this university. Yeah. Can I sign a 10-year contract as a coach? No, it's funny. It's like that most of my career, playing-wise, I was a bench warmer. It wasn't until the last few years of my club and high school level that I actually started playing meaningful time. But I took that bench time so valuable, sitting next to those coaches, that I absorbed, and I think it's made me a better coach because of having to learn the game. Is I wasn't the most skilled, wasn't the best player, but I learned the game from a strategic point of view, that maybe I can't do the crazy things you can do on the ball, but I understand the way of the game. And I think seeing the game is a big thing that comes later in life, but when you see a player that sees the game and can do it, then obviously that's superstar. But I think a lot of bench players become good coaches because they see and they're learning. And they know what they need to do when they go in. They get that extra. Substitutes have that advantage because they've already seen how the game's laid out. Mm-hmm. I think starting a game is a tough thing because when that whistle blows, you don't know what you're going to see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's almost like those super attributes that the players can learn on themselves. But to shut that attribute down, you got to be an observer. Like, if this guy's fast, what am I going to do to get him? Am I going to put my where's my footwork at? Where's my counter punch?
Yeah.
So it's
you might not know he's fast until he touches the ball.
Right.
Yeah. I tell a lot of my players, kind of glance over at the warm-ups, but really warm-ups can be, they're not showing all their cards in warm-ups.
No.
Mm-hmm. You know, so, Now just remind everybody, you're listening to World Sports Show here with Will, head coach of Junior Lone Star, John DiCriscio, co-host and producer. So John wears many a hats here. Always shout out the kudos to him because he's operating the board, playing some awesome jazz music tonight. Who was that that you played tonight?
Little Grover Washington Jr. You know, it says Jazz Month. You know, WPPM's LP Philadelphia Studios are playing all month jazz featured and poetry as well as by the previous show. But yeah, it's just a two-second story that Grover Washington Jr., you know, me going to elementary school in Philadelphia was our school sponsor for a couple years. And I just had the awesome, you know, going into class and having a guy, Grover Washington Jr., being in the class, like, hey, you know, talking to the class and I'm like, hey, can you play this song? And I'll just start picking up a saxophone and playing.
That's
and I'm
sick,
like,
dude.
That's awesome.
Hit this guy, you know, world-class musician here. And it's like, you know,
holy moly, that's awesome, dude.
So, yeah.
Comes full circle and you can play his tracks on the radio.
And I, you know, I was playing, hey, I always play Knucklehead. So I just figured I put on the song Knucklehead. And he's played with, you know, some of the best musicians in the world. And yeah, it's good to hear.
So we talked about that West Philly is where we do all of our practice in Junior Lone Star, and there's a big jazz culture out of West Philadelphia itself.
That's right. Philadelphia, West Philly, you know, Southwest Philly, there's a lot of jazz musicians. It's been forever, a lot of culture in West Philly.
Yeah, and you spent some of your time when you first moved to Philadelphia. You were in the Overbrook Session of West Philly, you were saying?
Yep. This is where I became Americanized, I call it. So you know growing up in West Philly, you know, going to Overbrook High School, you know, it was good growing up, you know, had some good experiences.
So I'm sure you've seen a lot of America, you've seen a lot of Africa. What's some of your staple about why you love Philadelphia?
Wow, I love Philadelphia because Philadelphia is, you know, I know this is a cliche, but Philadelphia is a blue collar city. You know, it's not like, you know, our neighbors of North and New York and, you know, those guys in D.C. there. This is a, you know, you earn what you deserve. You know, you get what you deserve in Philadelphia. So, you know, you put in work, you're gonna be rewarded kind of city. So that's what I like about Philadelphia.
I think that just totally fits our team that we have so many different guys on our team that are immigrants that just show up to work.
Yep.
That. Something about players that, you know, I've learned in the whole psychology. We're going back to psychology again about you have the privileged soccer players. Sometimes when they face adversity, they don't know how to handle it. Mm-hmm. Where these kids might say, hey, really? I'm worried about being down 2-1 in the 90th minute, dude. I'm glad I'm alive.
Yeah.
And it doesn't take motivating to get these guys on the same page where some people of more privileged backgrounds, it's hard for them to really understand life when they haven't really experienced life like some of our guys. So,
sure.
But Will, thank you so much for coming into the show tonight. Really appreciate it. I know you had to leave practice early, you know, so hopefully Kara led the boys and had a good session. I saw you doing some texting. It seemed like they were doing all right.
Yeah, he's doing all right. You know, they ended practice, and he had some good evaluations for tonight. We're getting ready for Sunday's. I think this is a regional cup for us. We're going to be playing ASF. Select. I think they're a team from Maryland, and you know, we're ready for them. I think this is quarterfinals, so we have
big time, man.
Three games to the Nationals, so we're gonna be all right.
Yeah, I've got my work cut out. You know, I'm on the fence about my two keepers, so I know they're both out there listening. So that this let us coaches make the tough job. So
exactly.
I'm not gonna tell them till game time. I'll let them work hard at practice. Who's the starter? You both are.
Oh man,
oh, man.
That's how you gotta make them hungry. Don't tell the 11 who the 11 are. Sometimes they gotta wake up to find out who the 11 are.
Exactly.
So again, everybody. I'm Charlie Flo. He's John Agricio and Will from Junior Lone Star. This is World Sports Show on WPPM LP Philadelphia. We'll be back in a week.